Yo, what's up guys, it's JD from JDTechGear, and today we're really getting into the nitty-gritty of PC passion today. So we're gonna take a look at this Asus B350-F motherboard, which is more specifically the B350-F Strix motherboard. So yeah, this is more going to be a review and not so much of an overview. An overview usually goes over what the specs are and everything like that and all its features and functionality. But today we're going to look into a couple more things like the VRM design, what kind of BIOS and overclocking we usually get out of this, what's the VRM temps, and stuff like that. A little bit more in depth than you would just get from listing off some features. So first, let's get pretty familiar with this motherboard and just kind of point things out, and I'm gonna explain some things so you know what the VRM is and all these other things and terms that I'm using that hopefully don't throw you off. I don't want you guys to get lost into this. I kind of want to explain why some things are good and why some things are bad and how to look for these things when you make your motherboard purchase. And of course, you can't always get all these specs from just looking at a motherboard and looking at the spec sheet online. There's always a little bit more that you have to dive into that you just can't get from the spec sheet. So first, let's just identify where everything is on the motherboard. Of course, this is the rear I/O right over here. This is part of the VRM design. There are two heat sinks that come with this. So this is the main heat sink for the VRM right over here. And this is the heat sink for the second part of the VRM over here that goes over here. And those reach a temperature. Well, the main VRM, this side controls all the power that goes to the processor. And I registered those temps. And at 3.2 gigahertz for the Ryzen 1400 under load using CPU-Z, we saw temps of about 38.1 degrees Celsius. And at 3.9 gigahertz, once again using CPU-Z, was about 47.1 degrees Celsius. So not too bad. They do their job. They do their job at cooling. And they're not super beefy, but they're adequate for the VRM design here. And the VRM basically controls the power to the motherboard to specific components. So just kind of getting a very rough outline. So this side controls the power that goes to the processor. This side controls the power that goes to your DIMM slots and your PCIe slots and the chipset, I believe. I could have that wrong, but just know that this side is your main VRM that controls the power that goes to your CPU. And if you're wondering why that is because you can't just take the power directly from the power supply going to the processor. That would just overload the amount of power that would go to it. You need some sort of regulation and control. So that's exactly what the VRM does here. We can see here that's our CPU power connector right over here. We have four DIMM slots which support a maximum of 3200 megahertz and up to 64 gigs of RAM. And these are a little bit different than what I'm used to. So the tabs only come out on one side. They don't come out on this side. These are fixed. And you basically just drop your DIMM in and then you just snap it in place rather than doing both at the same time. So it's a little bit different, just worth noting. Here's a USB 3.1 header, which is pretty generic. Our SATA ports, we have six of them here. Two of them are separated up here and the four others are separated over here, which is fine. I guess it's okay. I haven't had any problems with that. I'm not hooking up six drives to this motherboard, so for what it offers, I think this is fine, the placement. There are a limited amount of fan headers. I think there's only three fan headers, which is a little limited for this board. I'll go out and point where those are in a little bit, but over here we have our front I/O connectors, and I believe, yep, this is channel fan 2 and 3. So these are two fan connectors right here, which is fine, but I mean, having three fan headers, I think, is a little limited. I would have liked to have, like, at least one more, maybe along this side of the board over here. I think there's definitely room for one more fan header, and that would have been nice. But I would recommend getting a fan hub if you plan on getting more than three fans connected, unless you just want to go all Molex, and that's completely fine as well. What else do we have over here? This is our RGB controller right here. There's actually not the controller, but the header. There's two RGB headers. There's one right here in white and another one in white right over here. And there's our other fan header right here. That's the first one. This is for a AIO pump. So technically you could use this one for a fourth fan, but again, I still would like to see one here that is completely dedicated as a fan header. So that would have been nice, but you can technically use that since it is a four pin. You also have your CPU optional header over here. I believe the top one here is for the CPU fan, and this is the optional one. So there's that one as well. Got your USB 2 header over here. What else do we have here? Oh, okay, so here's two temp sensors. So these sensors right here, this motherboard comes with two sensors that you can attach right with these two pin headers, and you can pretty much monitor whatever temperature you have from the BIOS. Our PCIe slots right over here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them. There are no PCI slots. These are all PCIe, and I believe these are all Gen 3, of course, and they are metal reinforced. At least the top two are, and the bottom one is not. I think that should be something that's standard. Let's talk about the rear I/O here. Okay, so for the USB ports, we have four USB 3.1 Gen 1 ports, which are the blue ones. And then we have two USB 3.1 Gen 2 ports, which are the red ones. And then we have two USB 2.0 ports, which are the black ones. And then, of course, we have a DVI and an HDMI, Ethernet, and then all our sound stuff. So, yeah, that's pretty much it for the rear I/O. All right, so we're going to go in and describe the VRM. So the capacitors are these things right here, these black cylinders, which are on the motherboard, are pretty good, actually. These are, you want good capacitors on your board. You want them to last a while. These are Japanese-made capacitors. I looked them up. More specifically, they're MIL100/16 capacitors, and basically they're a tantalum capacitor. And I looked these up, and they're supposedly pretty reliable. So that's nice to have. So when you're overclocking and stuff like that, you can rely on these and expect them to have a long life expectancy. So that's nice. And we see here that we have a 4+4 design here. Not all the time will we have a 4+4 design, but basically what that means is that we have 4+4 phases, a total of 8 phases, 4 going to the CPU and 4 going to the rest of the board. So basically what that does, the phases, the more phases that you have, for anyone that doesn't know this, like I said, I would be describing all this. So basically with the power phases, it helps control and filter out the voltage that goes to your processor. The more phases you have, the more or the stronger the filtering is going to be that's going to your processor. So you would get a lot more stable overclocking essentially with more power phases. So four is okay for your CPU. With higher up boards, you get like 6 to 8 and possibly even more. But basically you can count the phases by counting these little squares right here. And those squares are called chokes. And those chokes, each choke corresponds with the other components that make up an entire phase. So you just count the amount of chokes, and basically that's the amount of phases. So we have four here going to the controller or the SoC. We can see here that we have another phase right over here, which is, there's a choke, but there's also a driver and a capacitor that's dedicated to the DIMM slots. So that's also nice to see. Also, I forgot to mention that we do have an M.2 slot over here that has support for multiple lengths. And also going more into the VRM design, we can see these little squares right over here. So you see these three squares. So basically that makes up a MOSFET, I believe is what it's called. You have a low MOSFET, a high MOSFET, and a driver. So there's three total. So on the lower end motherboards, you would see three total. On the higher end motherboards, you would see them all joined into one big square, which are essentially, that usually corresponds with a more efficient MOSFET that's going to be delivering power to your processor. So, you know, it's okay. Like I said, I don't know the exact amperage coming out of these MOSFETs that are delivering the power to your CPU. But as far as I know, they're okay. They're okay. I don't know the exact specifications of them. I tried looking them up and everything was in Chinese, so. But basically, you can do basic overclocking with this. And I'm able to get 3.9 gigahertz steady on this Ryzen 1400. And that comes in part with, you know, the Silicon Lottery, of course. So let's move on over to what the BIOS is like and what it's like overclocking on this motherboard. So this is the BIOS for the B350-F motherboard, and it's the same as the X370F, I believe, but there are a few minor differences. But basically, it's pretty straightforward. If you want to go into the basic settings and adjust like your fan speeds and everything, you hit F7 and it'll bring you to this screen. And you can see here that you have your temperature monitoring right here, your voltage, your motherboard temperature right here, and also your fan speeds. Right now we don't have any connected fans just because the motherboard doesn't have any connected right now because it's out of the box. And right here, this is the CPU fan, and if you want to control this one, well, you just hit Q fan control and you have control over your channel fans. And yes, there are limited options and only a maximum up to 3 fans. So I would recommend the fan hub with this motherboard in case you want to do more than 3 fans. But yep, you have all your options right here for choosing your fan speed for the CPU cooler. And if we want to go back to the other mode, we'll go back and hit F7, which is called advanced mode. Now this is going to be at a stock frequency of about 1.23 volts. So don't be afraid to push the voltage on your CPU to like 1.4, because to get my Ryzen 1400 at 3.9, I usually have to get it to 1.4 volts. Anyways, looking at the tweaker settings, this is where we can control all the overclocking and voltages and everything like that. So if we want to change the memory frequency here, it's pretty straightforward. You just hit enter and you have the drop down box, and you can choose a preset speed to choose which kind of speed you want to run your memory at. The memory I currently have in the motherboard does not overclock, but I have been able to overclock 2400 megahertz memory up to 2666. So it does do some sort of memory overclocking, and it doesn't do too bad of a job at it either. If you want to overclock the CPU, it's a little bit different. You just don't enter in the voltages like you would normally, like on a gigabyte board or anything else. It works a little bit differently. But first we see the CPU core ratio is at auto. So if we want to do something manual, you just type in. So if we want to do 3.9 gigahertz, we'd put in a multiplier of 39. And if we want to be a little bit more specific, we can put 39.1, and it will auto adjust to the closest increment that it has. So the safest frequency I've been able to push on the 1400 is about 3.9 gigahertz. So that's really it. And if you want to change the voltage, you have to do it like so. So we can see here the CPU voltage is at auto, which isn't really necessarily the best when you want to do overclocking. Of course not. So we have to go into offset mode. And what it does is it takes this base frequency right here at 1.25, and you can either add or subtract the voltage here. So we want to add voltage, and right now it's at auto, but we don't want to set it to auto. I usually set it to about 1.7500, and like it does with the core ratio, it will also do with the voltage and kind of increment. So basically you have to look at it as 1.25 plus 0.175, and that's your voltage. Anyways, I also like to go and control the power phase control and the load line calibration. So if you want to do that, go into Digi plus VRM. I hope that's how you pronounce it. And then you can see here that we have our load line calibration for our CPU, our SoC, power phase control, and our switching frequency. So I keep it at 200. You can push it to 300 if you want to. I like to set the load line calibration to maybe medium. You don't really want to go any higher than this. What was it? Buildzoid made a good video on Gamers Nexus about why you shouldn't push it any further than that. The SoC load line calibration, I don't change. I leave that to auto. And then the power phase control, you can set to extreme. Sometimes I do need it to set to extreme to just boot up. Sometimes it doesn't. It's a little finicky with the memory that I have in the motherboard, but I really wouldn't recommend overclocking anything more than a 4 or quad core in this motherboard. So yeah, so let's just run these settings right here. It has plenty of, you know, options for, you know, configuring what specific settings you want, and Let's see, and your boot option manager is all the way in boots, just like normal. And it's a pretty easy BIOS to understand. You do have to do a little bit of digging if you want to do the tweaking settings, and you have to play with it quite a bit. It's a little bit different with that offset voltage tweaking. So let's load these configurations and see if it will boot. It does have a little trouble booting sometimes, and I'll have to reboot like 100 times. Not literally 100 times, but quite a few times before it will actually start booting. Let's see if we get lucky. Nope, had to restart. So this is the problem with the memory sometimes. It'll say like total memory is only 8 gigs, and that's a problem because it just does not recognize all the memory. So I know it's definitely a memory issue, but we're going to still go ahead and just not change any of the BIOS settings and have to redo it. So you will have to do that sometimes if you have incompatible memory like I do. It's not fully incompatible, but it just does not work seamlessly with the Ryzen platform. Okay, we're able to boot into Windows. Let's bench CPU. Okay, so that was a pretty successful overclock in my opinion. We're running at 3.9 gigahertz. Fairly stable. We're able to boot into Windows and we're able to run benchmarks and stuff like that. That's how you overclock on this motherboard, and that is primarily kind of some of the issues that you go through if you're not using Ryzen compatible memory.
And as you can see with my memory, it's a little bit weird. You know, the memory isn't officially supported for the AM4 platform. I know that, so it does make it a little bit less stable when it comes to overclocking with this motherboard. But otherwise, you know, this pushes through that and works with it, so I'm happy with that. And so I can use not specific Ryzen memory and still be able to overclock with this board. So it does a little bit of hustling in that department as well, if that makes any sense. Basically, at $130, I think this would be a little bit overpriced, but it's still a good option for a B350-F motherboard. I think there's another Asus board that's a tier up from this one that's still a B350-F chipset, and I forget what the name of it is, but this one offers a good value. It's usually on sale for like $110, $104, sometimes even $94. And at that price point, I think this is a really good motherboard. It looks great too. I mean, it's all monochromatic. It's very, you know, aggressive looking and angular and looking cool and all that. But the capacitors are nice. The VRM is a little bit weak, you know, with a 4+4 design. And everything else is more or less okay. I would have liked to see more fan headers and stuff like that on there. And there's also like a little RGB strip in here, which is pretty nice. It looks pretty cool, but it stays on even when the PC is shut off. I don't know if you can turn that off in the software or not. I'm sure there is. Also, there's two RGB headers, which is nice to have in case you have multiple things that are being connected to your Aura RGB controller in here. Yeah, it's not super feature rich, but it has enough features on it. And for $110, I would recommend this board. The cooling is adequate on the VRM. Like I said, it's not that beefy, so it doesn't even have a lot to cool off. But otherwise, it's overall a pretty solid board. You get quite a bit of accessories as well. You get two temp sensors, you get four different SATA cables, two of the 90 degree angles, and two straight SATA connectors. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video, found it helpful. Maybe you learned a little bit of something. If you want to give any feedback, if I made any mistakes in the video, hopefully I'll correct that in post. And if I don't, I'm sorry. I'm still trying to learn everything. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed that video. Thank you all for watching. And let me know if you like this style of video, if you like the nitty gritty of PC parts and just getting them to be torn down and everything like that. Let me know. So it's a little bit different from what I do, but thank you for sticking around and trying it out. And thank you for watching. I'll catch you guys in the next one.